Welcome back to Buggeray, and in this video we are continuing with the cloning of the CBDX website. So in this video we'll be focusing on building the product view page where the user will be able to see the product together with its details and also have the ability to select the size which they want to choose, right? And have this add to cart button which is actually not working currently. So guys, I've also spiced up something in this video by purposely skipping some sections so that you guys can actually notice which section I've actually skipped, see the differences of what you're seeing now and what your end product is going to be when coding throughout everything that I'm showing you in this video. Reason I did this is not actually to spite you, but to help people at home to actually grasp the most out of this video. So please guys, ensure to watch till the end and don't forget to like, share and subscribe. So the end result of this video is now the user will be able to now go to the home page, which is this home page with what we currently have, and the user will be able to now click on a specific product and actually view that product which they're actually clicking to. So all of this, you'll get this from the video, right? So with all that being said, please don't forget to like, share and subscribe, and let's get to work. Before we even touch the code, let me run you through the themes.scss folder so that you can actually have a snapshot of the actual CSS variables we'll be using throughout this video so that you're not confused when we actually reference them, right? So let's go to the themes folder and then the themes.scss. So we've got these colors, which are CSS variables for the colors, and also have CSS variables for the font size, and CSS variables for the spacings and box shadow. So that's what we're going to be using. So you can quickly pause this, write them down or something, and throughout watching this video, when we actually use them, you can actually see which color it's actually using or whatever it is, whether it's font size or spacing. So now let's move on to the next section. So since now what we want to achieve with this product view page is actually so that when the user clicks on some sort of like a product, right, it will send them to this page, which is now the product view page, which will now render the actual product with the description and the price and selection of the options they want to choose and the add to cart button, right? So that's what we want to achieve. So for that, we'll need to create a page for that, right? So how we go about doing that is we'd want to cd in into the source folder, right? And then we'd want to cd in into the apps folder slash pages folder, right? So this will first cd into the apps and then also the pages folder, right? So now we're on this directory over here, right? So we want to create a component which is actually our actual page. So we'll say ng generate a component which is going to be our product slash view page, right? So now we've created this product view page. Now let's clear this console, right? So how are we actually gonna go about having to use now this component or page is actually now going to our apps routing and actually creating a route that's gonna route to that actual page. So currently what we have in this product view page is this product view works, right? So now let's close this out and go to our apps routing and create a route for that page, right? So we'll create this object with the path. So our path will actually resort to product view slash, and then this is the ID, right, that we're going to be using, right? So we'll have this component, and our component will be rendering this product view. No, that was a mistake. Product view this is the product view. So we need to just remove that product service. Was that one removed? Oh yeah, I think it is removed. So we can save that and ng-serve. Run that and see if our project runs. So that will take some time a bit. So what we want to now view is this, right? So if you come over here, actually this page, and just paste that and actually have an ID. So now this is actually rendering this first, this page, which is our products page. So it says product view works, right? So now let's quickly go to our product view page. Let's close this app's routing. So we'll go to pages, product view, and then we have on our actual HTML, right, page. So now what we want to do is actually create a product view container. So I like having this as just a wraparound, right? So, and then after that, we'd have like a sort of like, so this product view container is actually like an overall wraparound, right? And then we also would want to have like a product view content section. So this will actually wrap around the content. So we can actually then set a width for that product view section, right? Product view content. So we'll have this class called product view content, right? So product view content, we'll have that over there. And then we'd want to have, since now with this product view, what we'll be seeing is that we'll have this left section over here, which is going to be our image, and the right section over here, which is going to be the description, and so on and so on, right? So how we go about doing that in code, we'll have this image section. You can just specify the image over here, which doesn't actually matter. But we'd want to do it in a div form. And then the right section, we'll call that product detail section, right? So this is the product detail section. Right, so we'll save that, and then what we want to do is we saw that we have our p tag, and then we want to have like a class name called this product name. So that's the first p tag, and the second one will be the product description, right over there. Third p tag will actually be a selector, so a select. And then this will probably have like some options over here. So which the first option would be select size, right? Which is actually our default, right? And then we would want to have another option over here, which will have our small. And another section over here, which will have our medium. Right, and then yeah, I think that's fine. Now I need to remove this. Okay, yeah, I think that's fine. We've closed that and we can save. So when we actually now view it over here, we see we don't have anything. So I think now we need to fill in some stuff. So over here in the image section, we would want to have like an image. So with image, we'd say that, wanna go to our assets folder, our image, then we'll take that image. So this is just a product image, right? So this is just our product image. So if we save that over there, we should have our image showing. And then now we'd wanna have the name of the image, we'll call it Vaseline, right? And then we'll have a description, which we're just gonna copy this for now. So we've copied that, and we want to paste this Lauren Ibsen text over here, right? And then what we then want to have is that. Oh, so another thing that we haven't set now is actually have this BTN add to cart. So it's add cart. Can call it anything actually. BTN cart or BTN add to cart or BTN add cart. So that depends on you, right? So the class name will be that. And then we'll call it, and then the actual tag in there will be add to cart, right? Right. So now we have that sorted out for us. And now we see that we've got all our description and all those fancy stuff showing over there, right? So the next section is actually now going about actually styling this HTML, because now what we only have is just the skeleton of the page, but now we want to have this nice stylings that's actually gonna decorate our product view page, our product view page. So how we go about doing that, we'll go to this SCSS folder for the product view, right? Our first target would be this container, right? So we'll copy that, then we'll say that, or you can type it all out if you like typing. So what we'll do over there is set the width of this page to 100%, because we want it to fill in the whole page, right? Which is the actual idea, or the actual idea that I had when actually going about choosing this, creating this container, right? Before just going about adding some content in this container, right? So we've got this container which is now filling up like the 100% of our content, right? Or the width of our screen, right? So after that's sorted out for us, what we want to do over here is also then target this page, right? This class, which is our product view content, right? So we'd say now that over there, this is product view content, right? So how we'd go about now doing it is we want to change the orientation of the display, because what you see currently is that it's being displayed vertically, right? So we want to change that orientation to be horizontal. So how we're going to go about doing that is using this display flex, right? So display flex, and then we'd say this flex wrap, we'd want to set that to wrap. So now what we'll see over there is this. Now what's actually going on? Let's see. So we've got that over there, that over there, and that over there. So, what's actually not working out? What's not working out for us? So let's just remove this wrap for now. Probably that's what's causing this issue. Yeah. So how we would have like solved that issue, think we need to have this box sizing to border box, right? And then I think this wrap is gonna work. I don't know. Let's see. It's still not working. So I know why this is not working. So now the idea is, the reason why this actual wrap is not working is because now the actual width of the container is now filling up these two actual divs, right? So now when we wrap, we're actually telling it that if the content is actually cannot handle these two divs, then just take the second one and put it on the bottom. So just for now, we'll just take out this content wrap, right? This flex wrap, right? So we've got this displaying to the flex. So what we then want to do is actually now go about setting like our padding. So our padding will be, because we want to have like our left and right padding to be like 24 pixels, right? So say padding left and right. So what we can have, it's also have padding 0, which is the top and bottom, or we can use the CSS variable. So let's import this, and then we'll have /source themes and then themes.scss, right? So we would want to have the zero padding because we want to reference this zero padding, and then we want to have 24, right? So for that, I think we use this tertiary, I always can't spell this, padding. I don't know if that's fine. I think that worked out for us. So we've got 24 pixels to the left and right. So that's what we need, right? And then the next thing that we want to do is actually now go about setting the width for this image size and this actual product detail section. So image section, we want to set the width for that. So this class for the image section, so we want to set its width to actually be 50%, right? So we want to be 50% of actually this 100, of actually this 100%, right? So the width over here will be like 100. No, want to set that to like probably 90%, right? So, but we want this to fit in 50% of that. And then we'll also have this class for this product detail section, right? For this product detail section, what we want to have over there is actually set the width to also be 50% of that, right? So 50-50. We want it to be 50-50. So now we see that both of them are now filling 50-50, but now the image itself is still not behaving. So how we go about fixing that issue is actually now going into this image section and actually setting the width for the actual image. So we will go to this SCSS folder over here and target now the image, right? So we'd say now the width for that image, we want to say that the width should take 100%, right? So the 100% of that width will actually take the 100% of that 50%. I don't know if that's making sense. Yeah. So another thing that we would want to do is we can set like a flex column. Let's see if that's going to behave. Flex column. Is it flex? Oh, flex gap. Oh, I think it's gap. It's gap column. Is it? Flex gap. How do you set that thing? It's column gap. I think it's gap. Yeah. Grid gap. No, grid gap is for... No, let's try that out. I don't know if that's gonna work. Oh, it did work actually. So we want to set like the grid gap to actually be 45 pixels so that we actually have 45 pixel spacing between the image and the actual details. Whew, that actually worked. I actually even forgot that. I thought grid gap actually works for CSS grid. But yeah, you tend to forget these things. So yeah, so now that we've got out the gap between our image and actually our, we'd rather have the gap between our image and actually our details, right, for this product. So what we then want to set out over here is actually now the stylings for the text and so on, so on, right? So how we go about doing that is actually now setting for this title, right? So the title would actually be this product name, right? So we want to access this p tag for the product name, right? P tag for the product name, and we want to set the font size to be 34 pixels. Let's see if we have this 34 pixels in our themes. No, we don't have 34, so we can use 34. So we want to have 34 pixels. We want to set this margin. Want to set this margin bottom. Margin bottom, we want to set that to actually be this main padding. So it's a CSS variable for the main padding, right? Because the main padding is actually 16 pixels. And then we want to set the color to be blackish. This blackish color, right? So if we save that, now we see that we've got some sort of styling for that, which is actually nice, right? So now we want to now move on to the next section, which is now the description, right? So for our description, we'd also want to target something which is going to be our product description, right? So we want to have a font size for that, which is going to be 18. So I think 18, we do have font size for 18, right? So this will be font size 18. Sorry for that. And then we'd have our color, which is actually going to be our grayish color, right? And then our margin bottom will actually be our tertiary padding, right? And yeah, I think that's just it, right? So now let's see what we have. So we've got that font size of 18, that, and our spacing, right? So the next thing that we then want to do is actually now set the actual select. So we have a select, which we want to set the width of that select to actually be 100%, right? And then we want to set the height. Okay, but before we set the height, let's see if this width actually worked, right? Yeah, it did work. So we want to set the width to be 100%. We want to set the height to actually be the actual height for that selector. We want it to be 68 pixels, right? We want to set a background color to be this white color. So our background would be this white color, right? Want to set its font size. Want to make it this font of 18 pixels. And then we want to set the margin bottom. Margin bottom for that to be, we'll actually use 18 pixels for the margin bottom, which we don't have under those paddings. So we can use this 18 pixels. So we can use this 18 pixels, right? And then we'd want to also set the border, right? Do we want to set the border for that? Yeah. So we'd want to set the border for that selector. So the border will actually be 1 pixel solid. And then the border would be the secondary color. So secondary gray. So it will be the secondary gray. And then another thing we'd want to set for this is actually having the padding for the left and right. So padding for the left and right only, right? So 0 pixels for top and bottom. But for the left and right, we want to set it to 20 pixels. Do we have 20 pixels? I think we do, which is now secondary padding, right? So if we check in our themes.scss folder, secondary padding is 20 pixels, right? So moment of truth. Now let's see what we've done. Ooh, I think we did have something, but did everything work out for us, right? Let's check that out. Because we did have a left and right, right? So let's just say box sizing to border box. Let's just have that box sizing. Want to set that to border box, right? Okay, would love to see why that didn't quite work out for us, right? So the padding was for the left and right to be that, right? Oh, all right. All right, so I think this padding was supposed to be applied for our option. I don't know. Let's see. Did it actually work out? No, it didn't. No, it didn't. Yeah, I think it's fine over there then. Right, option. Yeah. So we do have the correct padding over there, right? Yeah, we do have it set to the left and right. But we'll probably check out why this arrow isn't shifted, right? So yeah, let's just remove that inspect and actually now do this coding, right? Let's see. That's fine. Now we want to set actually the stylings for the button, right? So what we'd want to do over there is you'd actually want to choose what you want to do. So you could have like some sort of like a button, right? Tag and then style that button. Or if you'd like to, you can just have a div and just create your own button, which is what I'm doing over here. Right, so we'd say that button card over there. So for this, we'd want to set the height of this to actually be 70 pixels. We want to set the width to actually fill the whole width, which is going to be 100 percent. And then we want to have the border. Want to set the border. So we would say the width of this border would be 1 pixels, and then like the border type, we want it to be solid. We don't want it to be a dashy border, right? So we'd want to set that to solid, and then the color for that border, we want to set it to this blackish color, right? And then we'd also want to set like a color. So this is actually like text color for this button, which is not actually gonna be this blackish color. It's blackish color, right? And then we also want to set a hover. So this is gonna be and we'll set an and. So this is and if we hover on this button, we want to change the background color, right, to this yellowish yellowish color, right? So we also want to set like a cursor to pointer, right? I think that's what we only need over there, right? So we've got that sorted out for us, is that now we have this color for the actual hovering, and the cursor and this actual text in there, right? So we see this as we see here, right? So we can also inspect over there. We see that we've got this text showing there in the middle, right? What we'll then also want to have is actually have like this text size for this add to cart button. I'd probably make that round about like 24 pixels, right, for this font size. So the font size, let's just say font size, I'll make it this font, font 24 pixels, right? We'd want to set this display, right? The display for this. So we want to set this display to flex. Display flex. So we can change the orientation of this display to be in the horizontal axis. But there's a reason why I'm using this flex display, right? And then we want to set the content for this actual text to be in the middle. Because as you see right now, I think it's still going to show. It's here in the corner, right? So what we will then want to do is actually now change that, right? So we want to say justify content to center to align it to the horizontal, center it horizontally, right? And then, okay, let's just quickly see that so that you can see it's horizontally centered. And then now we would want to also set its vertical center to be align item to center, right? So now it's going to be centered properly, vertically. It's going to be vertically centered, right? I'd want to change this sizing to like 22 pixels. I think 24 is quite a bit big. Yeah, I think this is fine. Over here, so we've got this button. So what we then want to do is actually now take this whole content that we have over here for this product detail and just center it vertically, right? So how we go about doing this is actually coming here and changing this display to flex. But display flex will actually mess it up, right? So how we fix it is we wanna then change this flex direction, right? So flex direction, we wanna set it to column, right? So this column would actually change the orientation of display flex to be vertically when we use flex direction column, right? And then now since it's column, we can't just use justify content center. Let's see. Oh, I think, yeah, we can use justify content to the center, right? Because if we use justify content to the center, it changes its alignment from, because if we've got like a normal display flex, which is now its flex direction would be like a row, which is horizontally. So if we justify the content to center, then it will center it horizontally. But if we change the flex direction to column and justify the content to a center, it will center it vertically. So if we say justify content center right there, now we see that this content will be centered vertically, right? So let's see. Did we actually need that? All right, so let's change this image. So over here, we wanna just change this height of this to be 576 pixels over there. And then we'd wanna set the height to be 100% as well, right? So now let's save that and see. Did this actually work out for us? Now let's inspect this 560. So the height of that didn't actually didn't even apply that height. Let's see. So that section, the height is 560, right? If we set important, let's just say important is something that I want to see over there. 560. The image says display this to that, right? Okay, let's set this height. Honestly, this 576 pixels, that's the height of the content, right? Oh, now the width. Okay, 560, that's fine. Okay, that's fine, right? So we want to see what they're actually using over here. It's five, that, and that. Oh, so what's actually killing us is actually this width that we're actually using over there, right? Because now this width is not necessarily aligning to what's there on that actual design, right? So how we can go about changing that is, so we've got that showing like that. So what will happen if we change this width? So 50%, but 50% is fine. 50% is fine because we want to change that to be 50% and this other oak to be also 50%, right? But what we can then do is the smart way. So we can play around with this width because since this is like actually like a percentage, right? So we can use 100% for that, right? And actually now use like 90% for this height, right? 90%, did I even save that? So let's just try using 50. No, 50%. Oh, so if we use that 50%, then we see a difference, okay? So let's just use 80%. Yeah, that changed the height. But now what we're seeing is this guy over here, right? This actual guy over here. So what we then want to do is actually now set this to say display flex, right? To actually horizontally align that and then align items to center, right? So now that will center it properly over there, right? So now we see that we've got this image showing over here. Now we also want to center this to that, and let's now change this to like 90. Let's see, 90 is going to work out for us. Yeah, I think 90 is just a bit fine for us, right? So we've got this image showing over there, and there, right? Let's see. Is align items to center even the correct way of doing it? Let me just close this and see. And see this guy over here. So if we go about closing this guy, yeah. So how we could have then messed this up is by using this guy over here. We can change that to like 80%. Since that's now 80%, another thing that we want to then do is actually say margin. We want to set this, no, not the actual margin. We want to display flex, right? And justify the content to center, right? So this will actually center everything that we have over here, right? And then we'll also have these guys showing in like that, right? But currently what we see is, yes, we can actually change like our options, right? But now the issue comes with the fact that when we actually change it, someone can then resort to actually selecting that select size, right? So how we go about fixing that, we want it to be the case that when a user actually clicks or selects a specific option, then you can't necessarily then go back and select this select size, because this is actually like telling the user that you actually need to select a specific size, right? So how we disable this is say selected, disabled, then we say hidden, right? So this will say that when we've actually trying to select, then now we can't actually select that select size, right? So which is fine over there, right? We'd also want to have value, set it to small, and that value also set it to medium, right? So that when you actually select something, when you want to grab whatever you selected, you actually get that value that you selected, right? I think the name and that, let's just say the name is product size, but the ID, I don't think we actually want the ID and the name as well. I don't think we actually did need the name, but hey, we can actually use it. So the next thing that we want to do is, oh, so now we see that everything is static currently, right? Which is currently not potentially that useful. So what we want to do is actually now use the service that we once used on our previous video, which is actually now using that get product service, right? From these services and this product service. So we'd want to get products, right? So how we'd go about doing it is you can, well, check it out on this product, because we will actually be using like the same logic. So we'll just mimic some API call, right, to this page. So how we do this is we'll have the service routed to this product and actually get the data from there and actually render based on that data, right? So in the product view page, we'll have this private product service. So we'd have this product service, which is going to be our product service, right? This is pointing to our product service. So on init, we'll say this dot product service, right? Dot, we want to get all our products. And what we want to set in there is just this product, right? So this product is actually pointing to this mock and products JSON, right? And then we'll say dot subscribe, want to subscribe to this method. And then as we subscribe to this method, want to get the results, or you can say it's data, anything you want, right? And then slash, and then this is where we actually get our error. So our error, which is also going to be of type any, and then we can console.log our error, right? Console log our error, and then we can also console dot log our data, no, which is results now, because we're not using data anymore, right? So if we go to our console, right, we'll see something over there, right? So we see this array of data, right? Let's see, did we have our ID? Did we actually have ID? Which is actually interesting because we didn't use ID. So we can fix that in this mock JSON and actually add an ID for all those products. So how we go about doing that is actually have this tag, say ID one, right? Then we'll just copy this guy over here. We'll close this one. This will be for ID two. ID two. Close this guy over here. ID three. Wanna close this guy. ID four. So if you wanna get this JSON, this you can get from like the previous video, right? ID four, ID five. Yeah. So we've got all our IDs. So now when we actually route to that page, we should get our IDs, right? So ID one, two, three, four. Where is four? ID five. No, why do we have ID five but not four? Which is kind of messed up, right? Oh, that was messed up. So, which one did we skip? Oh, this was ID 5. This was ID 5. And then we need to have ID 6. ID 6, right? So now what we have to have over there is actually this product view with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, right? So, which is quite fine for now, right? So what we want to display over there is actually saying that we'd want to filter this data based on the ID we'll be getting from the URL, right? And then get the image, the description. Well, and then we'd want to have these product size that we're going to be rendering, right? And that's just it. So how we do about doing that in code, how we go about doing that in code is actually now coming to this section over here, right? And then we'll have this product, which is going to be of type any, right? So this product is going to be of type any. So now we'll just say our product equals to results, right? So this dot product will now equal to our results, right? So that's fine. So since the product is now equal to this results, right? But we want to see it will equal to the results, right? Result. Let's see. Let's see. Okay. We want this product to actually be equal to this product.result. But we know that this product is going to return an array, right, of any. So we'd want to have products first, right? So these are our products, right? These are going to be our products, which is of that, right? Now let's save this. So products, okay. Okay. Now let's go here. And then this is going to be equal to an empty array, right? So this is going to be equal to these products. But what we want to have is also this, is that we want to say this dot product, right? Because we just want to have that single product, right? We'll just say this equals to this product that we just got over now. And then we want to filter. We want to filter this. And then just take the data that we're filtering over here, which is of type any, right? So how we want to go about filtering this is say where data.id, right, equals to 1. Just for now. This is just for now, right? This is just going to filter this one product that we have, which has the ID 1, right? But this is still going to be in an array, because even though we're filtering, right, it will just store that filter of this array, even though it's getting that one product, right? So then we want to have a product, right, which is of type any, right? So now our single product will be from this dot products and then at index 0, right? This product at index 0. So let me just call this our single product, right? We'll call it single product. We'll call this our single product, right? So our single product will equal to that, right? So now if we console.log our single product, let's see what we have. So yeah, so this is what we see over now, right? So from this single product over here, we want to come here, right? And actually render our image for that. So single products.image is what we have. So we want to have our single product.name. No. That's not what we want. We want to have single product.name. And then this lorem text. I think we want to remove that. Let me clear that out, which is actually a problem. Okay, so let's save this for now, right? And then we want to have this single product dot description, right? Let's see if that gives us something. We've got our product, single product, our description. Then we wanna have render this dynamically, right? So how we go about doing this is actually set it to this size. So this size, what we have here for the size is from this product size, and then we actually have, okay, it's actually a string, right? So how we do that is gonna be from our options. So we just say option, which is from going to be an ng4. This is an ng4 let item of single product dot product size, right? And then we'll just say the value is item, and then that's item, right? We've got small, medium, large. Right, that's what we want to show over there. So this is saying cannot read a property of undefined, although our image is defined, but it's saying cannot read a property of undefined, so we need that question mark to remove that error, I think. Nice. So why is it saying that we cannot, oh, product name as well, cannot, think every, all of them will need that. Even product description will also need this. This as well, we'll need that. Yeah, which is fine now. Good, everything sorted out for us. So now we see that we've got this product name over here, which is going to be this guy. And then we've got this text over here, which is going to be for our description. We've got all our selectors and this add to cart button, right? But now we've got the single issue, is that even though we change this route, right, to actually 2, we'll be still rendering the same product, even if we change it to 3, to 3 or 4 or 5, right? But now, how we can go about fixing this issue is actually coming here, right, and stop using the static number. So how we go about doing that is actually saying that, okay, we want to use this product private activated route, right, which is from this activated route, right? So we're using this activated route, so this dot activated route dot sub, so it's is it query parameters? Okay, so this is this dot activated route dot query parameters. No, is it dot params? I think dot. I seem to forget this thing. Data of any. Is it? So it's activated route, right? This is gonna be from this activated route dot, do we subscribe to something or something like that? Activated route dot, do you wanna take a snapshot? No. URL dot subscribe. Yeah, dot, yeah, we want to subscribe to that. I think we got to somewhere. Yeah, because this is from like some sort of like this URL, right? So what we want to see is just console log this guy, but I think it's parameters, if not mistaken, but we'll see that. So let's go to this inspect. So we've got this object. No. Okay, let's just say data is that, right? And then let's just see. Oh, so yeah, data is that. So that's the path. Yeah, I think it was query parameters. Dot query, not query parameters. Yeah, I think it's query param. Dot map. Let's see. Is there an issue with that? Did that even fail? Oh, it didn't. Wow, which was actually funny. It can't be query parameters. I think it has to be param maps, right? Because it has to be these params. Yeah, it had to be params. Oh yeah. So this is going to be from this param maps, right? Because these are the parameters, those slashes, right? No, the actual ID is actually the parameter. Sorry, my bad. So what we want to do is actually subscribe to that parameter, right? And then what we want to display is from this data.params.id. This is what we actually want to display. So data is 3, right? So we want to say let our ID equal to 0 as we start off, right? And then we want to set this guy over here, right? So this guy will be set to some sort of like a number, which is now this ID, right? So our ID equals to that. So our ID will be equal to this guy over here. And then we'll just wrap all this into this, right? So pre-param, instead of using 1, we'll be using that ID, right? Oh yeah. So now which everything is working right now, I guess, because what we want to do is actually get the ID of which we want to render, and then actually get that from this array. So now we know that if we now mapping to product ID 4, it'll change. And then if we map into 5, it'll change. But if we map into 7, we don't have 7, right? So what we want to do is actually say if we map into something that's not quite there, so we'll just have this ng, if this dot product, right? If we don't have this dot product, right, we want to route to the home page for now. So say private router, and then we want to say this router, right? So we want to say this dot router dot navigate by URL. We want this to navigate to the home page, which is just an empty path. So I want to say if, okay, let's see what we have over there, console.log, and then this products. Oh, if it's an empty path, right? So if this products.length, right, is less than equal to 0, right, we just want to redirect to the home page, right? So which is fine right now, right? Because now we're saying it, what we're saying is that if we don't, what we're actually saying is that if we don't actually find a product of that ID in this database that we have, right, or could I say mock our database, then just redirect to the home page, right? So which I think now everything is fine. So now moving on to the next section is, okay, let's just remove this console. All our consoles should be removed, right? So we've removed that, we've removed this, that. Okay, all right. So now we want to now move on to like our products page, because we didn't add like a route on our products page so that when we actually click on a specific product, we want to actually route to this a specific page, right? So how we go about doing it is adding the route from this click on this actual component, right? So on the actual component, if we actually click, right, this product card, from this product card, right? So if we actually click this product card, we want to say view product view, right? We want to call this method, which is going to be from this product view, right? And then this is going to be coming from this product product.id, because this is what we want to pass in, right? But this will give us like an issue, right? So what we want to do is actually have that method here in this products card dot ts folder, right? And then we want to have an ID, which is our ID is going to be the type number, right? So what we want to firstly do is when we click on actually either one of those cards, right, we want to just console log like what the actual ID is. So when we actually click on that, we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, right, which is all the products we have, right? So but now we just don't want to actually render those clicks, right, the numbers or the IDs, right? So we want to actually redirect to that product view page slash the ID of that actual product we want to see its details too, right? So how we do that is private and then product. So this is private router, which is from this router, right? Alright, so now we want to say is router.navigate by URL, and then we want to navigate to this product view slash okay, I'll just like using this curly braces, or I don't know what they call them. Where are they? These, yeah. So I want to go to the product slash view, and then I can just say $$ these curly braces and actually pass in the ID. So yeah, so now this will redirect to the product view slash whatever ID that we're passing in when we're doing the clicks, right? So if I save that and now click. So when I click on this product, it will actually view product one. If I click on this one, it will actually view this product. So if I click on this product, it will actually view that, right? So that's sorted. But now we also see that like in our card, we didn't actually add like a hover, so that when we actually hover on our product, we wanna see the actual cursor. So how we go about fixing that is coming to this product card CSS and say here, right, just put a cursor and pointer so that the user actually knows that this is actually a click event, right? So when we actually click here, we'll actually view that. Click here, we'll actually view that. Click here, we'll actually view that, right? So which is fine. And then here in this product view page, what we want to now remove is actually all our console logs. So let's see where we're actually getting these console logs from. So these console logs are coming from this products page. So where is the products page? So product page is coming from here. There's a console log. There you are. Want to remove this console log, which is now actually like us cleaning up our code. Oh yeah, so we see right now is that we've got this product description over here, right? Oh, the product name right there, got the product description. Then we've got the selector. Oh, and that's the nice thing, we actually see that there is actually a change on those selectors, right? So if we go back over here, come here, there is that. But for product one, you see that it's got small, medium, large, right? And then for these other products, I think it's just those milliliters, right? But there's also another issue that we have here, right? Is that after we did a selector, we actually see this outline, right? So how we can go about fixing that is actually coming to this product view page and then actually going to the selector, right? So on the selector, what we want to do is set the outline to none, so that when we actually selected something, then we don't have that outline, that bluish outline, right? So see, if I remove this, right, and then actually select something, you'd see this blue outline, right? But if you want to remove that, we'd actually Say that. And then now you can see that when we select something, we don't have that outline color, right? I think that's fine. Let's see. Are they doing it right? Okay, not quite bad at all. Not bad at all. Yeah. Think that's fine, 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 fine. Or fine, yeah. What else? What else can we do? Let's actually check our page. Let's see if we bring back this demon over here, which is our flex wrap. So in this product view content, right? Let's see if flex wrap still messes up our stuff. Yeah. Okay, flex wrap still messes up our stuff, but I think it's because probably of this grid gap, right? That's why that flex wrap is probably now messing up our stuff. It's because of that grid gap, right? But let's just remove that. And I think that's fine. We don't need that product wrap. Yeah, I think that's quite fine. And yeah, what we have currently here is that we've got this page where the user can actually have a filter, right? And actually see those products they want to filter for, right? And they can actually click on whichever product they want to view. So they want to actually view that product. And yeah, it is what it is. So I guess we have actually cloned that product view page. If you like this video, please, guys, don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. And please, guys, notice the struggle that I have to go through when going about doing these videos and actually preparing this. You can actually see the challenges that I also go through as like as some things where I'm actually recording the videos. I also face challenges whereby I need to figure out stuff and still remember all stuff on how CSS works, the HTML, and so on, so on. But I'm only doing this for you guys so that you can grasp the most out of this content. So please hit that like, share, and subscribe button.